All right. Hey, welcome to the show, Michael.
Thanks. Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
It's an honor to have someone who's won a couple of Pulitzers. And, you know, is it Pulitzer or Pulitzer? You're the one who's won them. You tell me.
I always say Pulitzer.
Okay, very good. That's what I'm going to say, since it's on your shelf and not mine.
Yeah. Somebody may disagree, but I think we're good.
Two-time Pulitzer winning editor and writer. And now for the story that we're going to talk about today, it's part of a package that has been submitted. And you're a finalist, right, for what we're going to talk about today.
Yeah. Yeah, we were finalists last week for international reporting.
Yeah, great reporting. I read it in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. Great story. It's amazing no one has heard of this. It had to be brought to me by someone, put it in front of my face and said, hey, you should read this. This is really interesting. And I'm thinking, why haven't I seen this on the news? And why hasn't Netflix done a documentary on this? I mean, I don't know, maybe it's in the works, but this is something, I mean, it has all of the casting possibilities, right? For all of these people in this, because I've seen pictures of the man we're going to talk about. And I mean, come on, that guy's just yelling to be cast in a movie on this. So great story. What we're talking about today is a story that ran in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, which was called Dirty Dollars. And it is about a Ukrainian oligarch who kind of burned across the United States, primarily in the Northeast, an area that if you follow the news a lot, you know, is in a very, very tough place economically. And in other ways, I mean, opioids are huge there. It's a place in America that's in a bad shape right now. And we'll get into that. But Michael had that story in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, again, nominated for a Pulitzer this year. And it really throws back the cover on some of the way that dirty money is working its way into our economy and leaving in its wake, right, a lot of damage to people and to places. So before we get started, Michael, I kind of wanted to just lay out some foundation here. And that is, because I don't even think I understand as fully as I should, what is an oligarch?
Walk me through an oligarch. The way you would probably describe it, typically they're Russian oligarchs, right? But they were the class of wealthy, powerful, often corrupt people who rose up out of the demise of the Soviet Union and took control of the local economies, grabbed control, sometimes violently, through violent means, sometimes through just sheer political muscle, because they were typically friends of Vladimir Putin's and others. And they rose out of the ashes of the demise of the Soviet Union and became very powerful figures in Russia and Eastern Europe. And that's where the name oligarch is often associated with in popular culture. But that's who they are. And they're usually billionaires.
So do oligarchs usually have like one lane? Like, I am the oil oligarch, or I am the development oligarch, I am the bank. How does that work?
No, they can own banks, mining, steel. Many of them were trained in metallurgical educations. They came out of that era of engineering. So they usually control vast natural resources. That's how you get really rich over there, is by taking control of gold mines, silver mines. But typically, then they get into banking. They may have various controls of banks, and it's multi. I mean, they are typically a wide, vast array of different kinds of industries, and they usually have pretty deep reaches into those. So that's typically the way it works. And lots of times it's metals.
Okay. And so an oligarch is dependent upon his friends, right? So if there is a new prime minister of Ukraine, or a president, I'm not sure, who's the titular head there with all the power? Is it the prime
right
minister?
Right now, and it's Volodymyr Zelensky is the president, and he happens to be a close friend of the oligarch that we wrote about in our project, investigative project.
And Zelensky came from acting? Wasn't he an actor?
He was a comedian. Yes, yeah, very good. He was actually, he had his own show, Servant of the People, and he played in this comedy the president of Ukraine, and it happened to air on the same television station and network that's owned by the oligarch that we wrote about and that he's friends with.
Okay. Wow. Crazy. Okay. So an oligarch would come in, and those people that he's friends with, or his family and friends program, they then are usually, right, they become oligarchs.
Yeah. In this case, they rise up because of political favoritism. Often they're kicking back to the corrupt leaders that they are friends with, and others, and they find a way to muscle themselves to the top. And lots of times, as I say, it can be done through violence and everything else.
And so in this case, Zelensky comes into power, right? He's the president of Ukraine. And he has a friend by the name of Igor Kolomoisky. Is that
correct?
Right?
Correct. Very good.
And who is Igor?
Igor is a Ukraine national. He was born in Ukraine, trained in metallurgical studies. He rose to power in the early 2000s. He formed a bank called Privat Bank. He also controlled natural resources, like he got not only into the steel industry, but in many of the alloys and the ores that go into steel. And he also bought into airlines. So Malta, and of course, then he owns these media outlets, right? So he owns one of the largest broadcasting networks in Ukraine. And he rises up, and it's through that bank. The bank becomes the foundation of his empire, because as more people start banking there, he has access to their money.
And that's Privat Bank?
Privat Bank in Ukraine.
And they are, at that point, they become, once he gets the oligarch status, sounds like he was already pretty close, right. Oligarch in name only. Once Zelensky comes in, why does Privat Bank become so big?
Well, Privat Bank was before Zelensky. Look, Kolomoisky's smart. He gets people around him that know what they're doing in terms of advertising, marketing, different strategies that allowed this bank to grow to become the largest in Ukraine. They at one time, and probably still do, have about 33% of all the deposits in Ukraine. And that the rest would be split up among many other banks. So they're the largest. And he was already a billionaire by the time Zelensky rose to power. And in many ways, Zelensky's rise was because of Kolomoisky. Kolomoisky and he were business partners. And, you know, Kolomoisky owned the network where Zelensky had control of his comedy, very popular comedy show. So when Zelensky gets elected president, you know, holy cow, all of a sudden Kolomoisky's back with the right political power. And now he's riding high in Ukraine.
You know, this is so surprising to me because, you know, we hear about Ukraine over here, and I've always thought Ukraine was kind of a first world nation. I mean, how can this happen? I mean, I know this, you didn't write about this, but I'm sure you've had a chance to observe it. Like, what is it like in Ukraine that these kind of swings, you know, between these oligarchs and power, and a comedian comes and becomes president? I mean, what is it? How would you describe the oligarch, government? And I don't know.
Sure. There are several oligarchs there. Dmitry Firtash is another one who is under indictment in federal court in Chicago for bribery. And he is in hiding in Vienna, and nobody seems to be able to extradite him to the United States. So that's another oligarch who's even wealthier than Kolomoisky, but probably not as politically powerful. Zelensky still controls many seats in the parliament there. You have to understand that Ukraine is an enormously corrupt country. really, really corrupt. Okay,
That's what I was trying to figure
out.
Yeah,
it's a part of the culture, sadly to say. Not among a lot of the young people. There's a lot of young upright. I work with a journalist there named Tanya Kozareva, and that generation wants to do it right. They really do. They love democracy. They believe in the friendships that we have with the United States, and they really want their country to get rid of this kind of rampant corruption that's been a part of Ukraine, you know, since its founding and since the demise of the Soviet Union. So this is the kind of country that fosters this, and it generates it generation after generation. There's been a lot of efforts by the United States, the International Monetary Fund, the United Nations, to clean up Ukraine. It's probably, I'm going to go out on a limb here and probably incur a lot of criticism from experts in our country, but I think it's better today than it was 15 years ago. That's probably not saying a lot, but it's a corrupt place. And so that's where this is where this all comes out of, everything that we're about to talk about.
Okay, that's helpful. Yeah, I was really shocked at you know, how all this occurred over there, because I never see Ukraine that way. I just never think about it that way. But I guess you're right. It comes from that Eastern European, that Soviet background, right? When people had to get creative to get ahead.
Very much.
It's probably genetic now. Now, he had a partner, right? Gennady Bogolyubov?
Bogolyubov. Bogolyubov. Yeah, he's another oligarch. Yeah. Much quieter. Mm-hmm. They formed Privat Bank together as younger oligarchs 20 years ago. They're both around, I think Bogolyubov's in his 50s and Kolomoisky's in his late 50s, but they started together on this run, and they're both enormously wealthy and both very powerful dudes.
And they're both the major shareholders in Privat Bank, which by now is the largest financial institution.
Correct. Right. Yeah, until it was taken over by the government in 2016, they basically controlled the bank. In fact, Bogolyubov had a critical role within the bank. So they were covered in every way. That was their baby. And they ran that bank like a sole proprietorship.
Do you know how much money was in that bank? Like,
billions and billions. No, I don't. I should know that, but it's enormous. It was it is the largest bank in Ukraine and among the largest in Eastern Europe.
Okay. God dang it. All right. So why do we care? Here's why we care. Because I think around 2006, right? Igor decides to, set up shop in the United States. And so Igor goes on a spending spree, and the spending spree is financed by embezzlement from his bank, the bank that he and Gennady are the major shareholders in, the largest financial institution in the Ukraine. And so they have employees, right, that are loyal to them. They're just sending deposits to him, or they're writing. How are they setting all this up?
Yeah.
How are they moving
it? Well, yeah, you have it right. The way it worked was they owned the bank, so they could basically control things. So within the bank is what they call the shadow bank. These were people that were loyal to both oligarchs. And what they did was they generated loans. And those loans, in the millions of dollars, none of them were small loans. Some were in the hundreds of thousands, but most of them were in the millions. And those loans went to shell companies controlled by both oligarchs, registered in the Caribbean, like the BVI was a big place, the British Virgin Islands, and St. Kitts, Nevis, those areas of the Caribbean. Those are notorious holes for money laundering and financial crime. And that's where they would register their companies. And so these loans would go to these companies, and there's no beneficial owners listed in these companies. It's usually the registered agents, the lawyers, the operatives, if you will, that would set these, that these would basically be in their names. So on paper, nobody knew the two oligarchs owned these dozens of shell companies, but that's where the loans were going, and that's how they managed to loot the bank.
So for the average person who's looking over the banknotes, what they see are looking over the records, they just see that suddenly Privat Bank is loaning a hell of a lot of money, hundreds of millions of dollars, to all of these companies that are based in the British Virgin Islands and St. Kitts, et cetera, right? If you look a little deeper, you'll notice that there's no, you know, individuals, you know, that are tied to them. It's just attorneys and, you know, dudes that set that kind of shit up. So now they've got the way to get the money out of the bank that they control, the largest institution in the Ukraine, financial institution, which just blows my mind. And so they're moving that money, the two oligarchs, to these blind companies, right? Boom. Yeah. So now they got the candy jar. So candy jar is now set up in the British Virgin Islands. What do they then do with all that money that they're moving?
Well, one interesting little piece of the puzzle in between is that when you put these loans out, they move the money through sometimes 25 different companies. So it'll go through from one shell to the next shell to the next one. It's called layering in money laundering. You know, the further away you get from the source, the less likely the source of the money is going to be discovered by forensics and regulators, what have you. So they layered the money through many companies until it arrives in the United States. And it usually...
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you a question about money laundering. Why do you have to launder money? Because I hear about it a lot, and I think that a lot of us only know what we know about money laundering from two sources, Ozark and Breaking Bad, and like that.
Those are pretty good ones. Those are pretty good.
So what did you learn as a reporter? Why do they have to launder the money? And what is the usual way that people do, you know, launder money?
Well, there's multiple, multi different ways. You can do it through real estate. You can do it through securities and everything. But at this point in the laundering process, so it takes on a lot of different forms. But one thing to be sure is that when they're doing this, they're stealing. So they have to cover up that crime, right? So in order to cover up the stealing, they have to conceal the money and find a way to clean it. We call it laundering because they're basically taking dirty money because it's stolen. Those loans are all given for many of them falsified reasons. Many of the loan documents would say, well, this is going to a steel business in Ukraine. No, it's not. It's going to buy a skyscraper in Cleveland, right? So the point is, many of the loan documents are falsified. So how are we going to cover up fraud and theft? We're going to do it by moving the money through as many different channels as we can so that you can't follow it anymore. So at some point, you're going to say, whew, I lost sight of it. I can't trace. You got the old phrase, follow the money. Mm-hmm. It keeps you from following the money by doing it that way. That's the laundering process. It's called layering.
When they do the layering, does this all happen by computer in one day? Or does it like they have to move it to one, then they have to wait a couple of days and they move it to the second?
Great question. They had an algorithm going in a computer. They knew when these loans could be let. And then when the loans were due, they would have new loans go and pay off the old loans. And that's a further process of fraud and money laundering, because now at this point, you're attempting to conceal the original money stolen by using money that was subsequently stolen to cover up your tracks in that regard. They did that all the time. And computers often would be the source of this. The computer algorithms would be set up so that when one loan was let, another loan down the road, or when that was due, would be paid back.
Wow, man, that is crazy. So it's all done by computer now. It was done by an algorithm. So everything was like automatic. Like the computer would know, okay, that one came due, boom, this company pays it off. Now we're moving the money to company X. Now wow, that's amazing, man.
They had their own system going.
That's
when you own the bank and you control the people within the bank.
Sure.
The key. Yeah. Then it's your baby. I think in the Privat Bank lawsuit, which is essentially the government, when it sued Kolomoisky in Delaware, the reason why is the companies that they had set up here to receive the money were set up in Delaware because It's Delaware is another notorious place for setting up companies where you don't have to disclose ownership. And when they did that, they would their reasons for moving it through all these channels was so that there's no way you can track it even within the bank. So they had people in the bank in key positions doing their dirty work for
them. Damn. Okay. So now our oligarchs, they got all their, they got their algorithms working. They got the money flowing. They got the companies growing, right, in the British Virgin Islands. And now they want to go shopping. Now they want to spend their shit. So they go to Cleveland, right? They go to Ohio. Like, that's part of it that I don't understand. Like, why did they go to, you know, some of these economically, which might be answering my own question as I ask it, but why did they go to some of these places in such economic dire straits like Ohio and outer, you know, and outside of Detroit? And why the hell did they buy what they bought? So you want to take us through that?
Sure.
Shopping spree? Sure.
Yeah. One thing, just to add just one more quick thing, not to make this more complicated at all, I promise you. But the bank that moved all the money, in order to get money, okay, in order to get money into the United States, you have to turn to a bank that's registered here, right? They use Deutsche Bank. You should know that because that becomes significant and will become significant down the road. So we track $750 million. Into the United States through shell companies and then ultimately through Deutsche Bank into the United States. So that's kind of important to note, and we can talk about that later, but Deutsche is what you call an intermediary. They're the ones that are saying, hey, we'll take the money into US dollars for you. Don't worry, we got you covered. So why Cleveland? Think about it for a second. A lot of money launderers go to Miami, New York, right? They buy expensive playthings, you know, diamonds and all sorts of things. Kolomoisky is the 2006 to 2008. We're kind of in the throes of the Great Recession. And all these properties, these skyscrapers you can buy are in Cleveland. They buy these historic buildings. One has the largest bank lobby in the world, which is somewhat ironic, right? But they would choose a building called the Huntington Building. And but they decided they could get them at great prices. And then when we got out of the recession, they would be that much richer, right? That property would increase in value. So they started buying skyscrapers. One Cleveland Center, the Huntington Building, 555 Public Square. These are all big, nice, old historic buildings in Cleveland. They're a big part of their signature skyline. And then they decide they're going to buy two office parks in Dallas. One was the headquarters of CompuCom Systems, which are computers. The other used to be the headquarters of Mary Kay Cosmetics.
Nice.
So they buy those. Mm-hmm. So they buy those two big office parks. Yeah, they bought a skyscraper in Louisville for much of the same reason. But then Kolomoisky and his partners started investing in steel. They started buying steel mills. They buy Warren Steel in Ohio.
It's a
they
big buy, steel mill, right? Of those that exist.
Yes, these are all iconic steel mills in the hills of Kentucky, West Virginia. Mm-hmm. They're in Indiana. One was in Buffalo, New York. One was in Midlothian, Texas, and they had 13 at one time. They actually bought 13 steel mills. Interestingly enough, one of them.
Can we break it there for? Let me just back this up for a second because.
Sure.
Okay, so we have a couple of oligarchs. I picture them in their bathrobes with sunglasses, you know, like walking down the street in slow motion. So we got two Ukrainian oligarchs. They're rolling into Cleveland. They've just bought the waterfront. And now they're buying 13 steel mills. Don't the city fathers and mothers of Cleveland go, hey, who are these guys?
Oh, it gets better.
Okay.
It gets better and worse. They bought a hotel there called the Crown Plaza using stolen money. Then they turned to the city and said, we want to fix this up and make it a four-star Westin. So would you give us a lot of your low economic development loans, the ones that are like 0%, right? There's so little interest rates. And they got them. So they got $43 million in loans from the Cleveland International Fund, from the County Port Authority, and from the County Commission, and from the city. The city of Cleveland gives them $43 million in loans so they can turn this Crown Plaza into a four-star Westin.
Did it ever happen?
Oh, yeah. They got the money, and now they've reneged on all the payments, and
but I thought, I don't know, maybe they did right
foreclosures going on in all of these facilities now.
Okay, so they had 13 steel mills, all the waterfront in Cleveland. They have the 484 room hotel. Was that the Westin that they had that they wanted to
go? No, that was the Westin. That is correct. Yes.
Okay. And then they have the office parks down in Dallas. So they're just like, they're kind of, and so, okay, here's, so to launder money, I'm assuming, okay, here's what I know about laundering money. And I appreciate what you talked us through a minute ago, but I'm imagining I have somehow taken $1 million, right? And now I got to get that $1 million clean. So I go and open up a strip club, right? All cash, hard to trace the transactions, right? I have my buddies go in, right? And they take in, you know, each one of them takes in like $200, you know, we do that over time. But at a certain point, all that money comes back out to me in a clean manner. How does that work with this stuff? Because a lot of the money that they're quote unquote laundering is now being tied up in what seems to me to be very, you know, high cost, high overhead, highly regulated. I'm just trying to understand, you know, the math. I get the whole flipper mentality that they were thinking. Hey, we'll go low, we'll sell high when we come out of it. I get that. But geez, they have all their money tied up in these, you know, pretty big projects. It seems like there's an easier way to launder your money. So help me understand what they were thinking.
Of course. It's a great question. Two things. One is that they were really wanting to make money. Clean the money. Most of the laundering was basically to steal through this. It was to cover up the stealing of the money.
Okay.
But once they got it here, they bought 22 prime pieces of real estate between skyscrapers, office parks, and steel mills. They also bought a Motorola cell phone factory in which is a very sad story, in suburban Chicago. So here's what happened. Two things. One, the market didn't do what they thought it was going to do in Cleveland and other places. That is, that it would really increase and do as well. It was a bad calculation. Two, they had bad people here running their facilities. They were bad business people. They made very poor calculated decisions. And this isn't on Kolomoisky. This is on really his handlers here. Don't forget, he's banned. During the biggest years of him purchasing things, he can't get a visa to come into this country.
Oh, I did not know that. So he's
His money is good, but he's got a visa. But no, it's something that just came up recently in our reporting.
Okay.
So he can't get into the country. That's the irony of all of this, is that his hundreds of millions were welcome, but he couldn't get in. Okay. But so we'll come back to Deutsche Bank a little later. I'll explain why that becomes a critical piece of the puzzle.
Okay.
So, but the steel mills were badly run. They put nothing into the safeties. You got explosions. You got these arc furnaces in Warren, Ohio, exploding, and steel workers becoming injured and hurt. See, number one. Two, the environmental, they were doing nothing to invest in the environment. And again, this goes back to his handlers. He had two key people,
okay,
his compatriots. They were his lieutenants in this country to represent he and his money. And they're both in Miami Beach. And they're both on paper as the officers of some of these steel mills and owners of the properties. Once they established here and bought the properties, they have certain delegated lieutenants who became the presidents and whatever, and investors. So these two guys were buying these facilities and running them into the ground, just running them into the ground. It didn't go well.
So were the was that Marty Korf? Was he one of them?
Yeah, he's one of the Miami Beach handlers, lieutenants, identified as a lieutenant by the Department of Justice and the Ukraine government. He was also a tiny, small owner of Privat Bank. He owned about, a less than 5% share in Privat Bank.
Who was the other one? Was it?
Uriel Labor. Uriel Labor, L-A-B-E-R. And he's also, these guys were also back and forth between Ukraine and Miami Beach, buying up these facilities.
It seems like one of the problems that they had, as I just look at it, right, as a guy with no background in detecting, but they got guys from the Ukraine who I don't know if they have the most stringent environmental protection rules out there, right? No, no. And so I don't think they're even thinking about, oh, what do we do with this steel mill stuff? I don't know, just throw it on the ground, bury it, you know? Oh, what do we do about our workers? I don't know, what are they doing to Ukraine? I don't know, tell them to walk it off. So is that part of the problem too? They just, they got the wrong guy, the wrong culture?
Yes, they ran it like you would run a place in, you know, Moldova or Kazakhstan. Yeah, they were just poorly run facilities with not only labor problems, but horrific workplace safety issues and violations. OSHA was in these plants all the time. And third, they were just not good business people. You know, they're still in a fight with the Ohio Attorney General in Ohio over all the Warren Steele. They left this place a cesspool of toxic waste and chemicals leaching into the Mahoning River. And they're still in a fight to get them to pay and to clean up this site completely, to finish the job that they were supposed to start. It's just, it's a horrific place. And you can see that in dirty dollars from our drone photography that we did over. You can see this place looks like something out of a industrial nightmare. And they just abandoned the place in 2016 and left all these workers without immediately medical insurance or the ability to even access the retirement funds.
Yeah. And that was, well, before I say that, you know, if people are watching this on YouTube, we will have the pictures up of everything that Michael's talking about. So we do, I have seen the pictures of the Warren Steele property, and it looks like a war zone. So yeah, we will have the pictures up if I think that's a better way to experience this interview. So you can actually see the folks that we're talking about, and you can see the properties that we're talking about. They're really sad stories, because the Warren Steel Mill, as far as I know, it was like an institution in that poor dying town, and people had worked there for generations. And suddenly these guys, you know, the oligarchs come in, they buy it, and they just run it into the ground. But it wasn't just running the factory into the ground. They ran these lives and these generations of people from Warren, Ohio. They ran their legacy into the ground. And now what are these workers doing?
There many of them are unemployed. Some of them, the ones that were hurt, one of them is permanently disabled. The other one, the ones that got hurt in the explosions are really sad cases. And I have to give Congressman Tim Ryan credit. He reached out to all those guys after our story ran to try to help them, you know, and try to get disability for one of them and stuff. So great credit to Congressman Ryan in Ohio for the work that he's done. He's been fighting for the workers for a long time. But yeah, and that's Warren Steel was once known as Copper Weld. And Copper Weld was one of these iconic companies. It was headquartered in Pittsburgh, and it became a real backbone of American industry. If you remember, obviously World War II, you know, Rosie the Riveter and all these people, you hear about these stories about people going into these factories and making the machines, making the parts that would help us fight the war in Europe and elsewhere. And this was one of those places. So it goes way back. Mm-hmm.
What happened with Motorola factory?
That's a sad story. That's a really sad. Yeah, great quote. Well, here again, they buy this facility. It was once among the largest cell phone company factories in the country. And Motorola closed it in 2003. They had greatly lost out to Nokia at that time in the cell phone industry war. And they missed various digital advancements. So they closed it down, right? At one time, it employed thousands of people. It's a huge facility. So the good folks in Harvard, Illinois, which is a suburb maybe 35, 40 miles outside of Chicago, they were long waiting for the next white knight to go into this big, beautiful facility, right, and do something. So when Korf and the others working for Kolomoisky and with him purchased this place, they're thinking, oh, my God, this is great. We're going to have, and they said when they came in, we're going to look for tenants. We're going to get you back to work. We're going to help the economy here. And they could not have been happier. And they ran this place into the ground. They stopped paying the taxes. They stopped doing upkeep on the facility. They didn't pay the utility rates. So Edison, or electrical company in Illinois, shut off the heat in the wintertime, and the entire fire suppression system, the sprinklers, all exploded because the water that was filled in there, it was frozen, and the pipes exploded. So they destroyed the fire suppression equipment, and they never put anything in there. It became a disaster. A tax lien company bought it and then put it up for online auction. And another criminal, unrelated to them, from Canada, buys the place. And the Canadian government gets the DOJ to put a freeze on it. So that place is still locked down with nothing to show for it. And if you look outside, it's got weeds growing, and it just looks like this was a state-of-the-art American facility at one time that was in a position to put in any major manufacturer. And now it's just, again, it's another industrial wasteland of how they left in their wake empty, boarded up buildings, unpaid property taxes. I mean, they left a real mess in the process.
Oh, that is really sad. You know, I have this little thing where I go and I try to look up the histories of all these little towns in Illinois or Illinois. I'm never sure how to pronounce it. How do you pronounce it? Illinois or Illinois?
Illinois, without pronouncing the S.
Without the S. All right. In Illinois, and there's so many little towns that at one point were like the place for industry. And one of the ones that really gets me, and I know I'm getting off subject here, but I'll get right back, is a place called Cairo, Illinois. It's down at the two great rivers meet, and it's virtually abandoned. And you look at Cairo on the map, and you're like, oh my God, that should be a major town. I'm going to drive down there. It's almost completely abandoned, and it's almost. And it's pretty much, I don't know if you're familiar with the story behind Cairo, Illinois, but it was really because the railroad moved and people stopped using the steamships. And so, yeah, they're right there at the meeting of two great rivers, but unfortunately, no one uses those rivers anymore and we don't take trains. So really interesting story. I still follow that one a lot. If anyone wants to go into a rabbit hole, there are a number of good documentaries on Cairo, Illinois on YouTube. But anyway, all right, back here. So another poor stepchild Illinois city taken advantage of and left at the curb. What do you think their glory years were when they were thinking, all right, we got this stuff rolling. This is going to keep us going forever. When were those years that they were feeling this?
You mean the oligarchs?
Yeah.
The oligarchs?
Yeah.
Yeah. More probably 2006 to 2011. That was their like, whoa, they got this gravy train. They got hundreds of millions coming into the country, and they are amassing a real estate empire, essentially. I mean, think about it. 13. Yeah. The fact that they got into the steel industry at a time when the United States government is supposed to be protecting these industries because they are critical components of national security and our infrastructure, and steel. The fact that they managed to get in here and buy up all the steel, and keep in mind, the factory they own in West Virginia called Fellman Production is the largest producer of silica manganese. And what is that? It's a critical alloy that's used in 75% to 80% of steel making. It cleans steel and it makes it stronger. And so it produces a very strong end product in steel. And it's used by steel makers all over the country. And they're the largest producers. So think about this. You got an oligarch from Ukraine who's banned from coming into the country, and yet he controls one of the most critical alloys in steel making in America. Put that together.
So I'm not the Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter, Michael. How did that happen? How did that fall between the
cracks? Well, that's one of the big questions. I mean, I think we kind of fell asleep at our switch. Anytime, you know, one of the great guys, Jay Westbrook, is a former counsel, longtime council member in Cleveland. And I asked Jay, why did you guys, how did you jump in bed with these guys? He said, Mike, first of all, we didn't know who they were. Nobody really bothered. When they're coming in town and they got all this cash at a time when we're crawling out of a recession with one of the highest foreclosure rates in the country, we were like people in a desert without any water. And all of a sudden somebody's coming along with jugs of water. And were we going to ask them, hey, where'd this water come from? Nobody bothered to ask the questions very hard. And that's really critical to this whole story, is the lack of due diligence that was paid almost at every level, local, state, and national. The only folks that ever asked any serious questions, at least in public records, was the Consumer Advocacy Division of the West Virginia Public Services Commission. When they went in and wanted to get reduced electric rates for their steel mill there, and they got it, by the way, the Consumer Advocacy Division says, wait a minute, these guys aren't submitting audited financials. Who owns them? What kind of structure? Who are their affiliates? Why are we giving them a checkbook and passing the cost on to the ratepayers?
But then they did it.
And nobody answered the question. That was it. They raised their hand and said, we don't think they should get it. And the state says, hey, this is about jobs. It's about keeping factories open, you know?
Yeah.
And so one person did raise the red flag and they blew them off.
You know, man, it reminds me of like a young guy in high school and the hot chick comes over and, you know, acts like she's going to talk to him. That guy will hand her everything, right? Everything. He's hoping, oh, maybe she likes me. Yeah, mm-hmm. This is it. This is my shot. And then she goes and, you know, walks off and goes to the next guy.
Walks off with the quarterback.
With the quarterback. Back to the Ukraine.
Yeah, that's right. And he's so calling sad. The shots. Yeah.
All right. So when did it start falling apart? And I know it's still in process and we're going to get to that. But when did the empire start? But, oh, by the way, there was an American involved in here, a guy named John Gulish, right? Wasn't he the COO or Goodish?
John Goodish was the former top executive at U.S. Steel, one of the top executive steels of U.S. Steel. He retired in 2010, I believe, and he was out there as a consultant. And they hired him and put him on one of their boards to overcome the steel industry. And John, John did try to implement better safety standards in the factory. But yes, and of course he told us, I didn't know it was owned by Igor Kolomoisky or Gennady Bogolubov.
I thought it was Mati, right?
Or he knew Mati Korf. He thought Mati. This we all thought this was Mati's money. So that's how he kind of justified it in his mind.
That's almost worse, right? I would have cared more if he would have said, you know, I thought Igor was a good guy, but like, you know, he's going Mati. Mati's like a third rate oligarch, right? He's like an oligarch, you know, handyman.
So, certainly the lieutenant, certainly a servant to the oligarch. One of the key people from Ukraine told me Kolomoisky was the daddy. He was their dad.
That's a good way to know. Yeah.
That's how he described it. And Korf was the underling who was carrying out, according to the DOJ, was carrying out all of these missions for him.
Now, I'm going to be an odd question. I know this is organized crime by definition, but is it tied to Ukrainian organized crime? Or is it just oligarchs being oligarchs?
No, it's another good question. No, it is tied to Ukraine organized crime, except there, if you're an oligarch, you can get away with it. That's basically okay. what they have done several criminal investigations of Igor. They have never charged him. He was a suspect in a contract murder. He has been, he took over an oil company owned by the government once using his goon squad. He came in and they took it over one night, and he took over a steel company in 2006 by sending in a team of men carrying crowbars and hammers and sickles and everything else.
You know, when you bring a sickle to the party, it's going to get real. So yeah, that's my motto. Yeah, if somebody enters the party with a sickle,
and you'll more than likely get the you'll more than likely be able to take over. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So how did it start? How did the empire start? Who caught on to it? Was it you? Was it your reporter?
Sure. No. In 20, they started doing what they call stress tests on the various banks, looking at the
different. Oh, right. Yeah. As we came out of that.
The government interceded, and it was two women played a critical role. I'll mess up their names. One is Katerina and the other is Valerie, so that's the most I can tell you. I can give you their last names, but I have to probably spell them out for you. But having said that, these women took it upon themselves to really start to look hard at
into Ukraine.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
so it starts there, and the government starts to really make noise and starts to do these stress tests, and eventually they nationalize the bank because they do a forensic audit. Well, I'm sorry, the forensic audit came later. They agreed that this was in trouble, that they would need to take over the bank because of the suspected massive fraud. So they nationalized it. They basically expropriated the bank from Kolomoisky and Bogolubov. Then they had Kroll, which is the world compliance forensic expert, come in and do a complete colonoscopy on the bank, basically. And they discovered that the bank had a $5.5 billion hole in its loan portfolio. And they started tracking those loans, and they started finding everything that we're talking about. And I don't know if this has been promulgated yet, but there's no doubt that people within the shadow bank probably started to flip and basically tell them this is what we were doing. Then they got, and so now that the government controls, it's called the National Bank of Ukraine, which is that's the regulatory agency. It's not actually a bank. They went in and did, they started to basically, they have access to the computer system and all the loan documents and electronic documents, and they start following the money. And they have the ability to do that now, to basically do that deep, deep forensic dive and piece together all the intricacies of the fraud. And it was massive. And they came out with a press conference in 2018 to basically say, after 2 years of owning the bank, this is what it did. They almost destroyed it. Now, what does that matter here in the United States? That meant that the gravy train was over. So when they started getting into problems and things where they needed to either fix up their factories, pay their massive bills, this and that, they were unable to do so. They didn't have that stream of capital anymore coming in. So at that point in time, they had to start filing bankruptcy for some of the steel companies. So four of the big steel companies went into bankruptcy, and they represented 9 of the steel factories of the 13. They stole the one in Detroit that never really got up and running. That was basically just a laundering mill. Warren Steel they abandoned, and one of them they still own. Two of them they still own. We believe the second one, CC Metals and Alloys, is making bitcoins now in Kentucky.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, it's making bitcoins now. But and then Feldman is still producing the alloy that is continuing to keep them in operation, but with a much smaller crew of workers. So they basically ran out of money. They basically, it ended with the takeover of the bank. And no longer did they have that cookie jar anymore.
But they're still in operation, right? The oligarchs.
One company, the rest are all, I think they have $1 billion in Cleveland left that they still control. The others they've lost through foreclosures, forced sales. There are forfeiture actions underway by the Department of Justice, civil forfeiture, to take over some of these places because they lay out very clearly they believe that they were the object of a massive criminal scheme, and that's how they obtained them. So they're trying to take those over. And that's where they're at today. They have one factory running, and they have two, I'm sorry, the other making Bitcoins, and they have one skyscraper left that they control in Cleveland. And the rest are all under lock and key.
Now, I'm assuming that a lot of local governments, I'm sure there are civil suits. I think there are some civil suits from the people that were injured. Right. And I mean, we're talking bad injuries, right? We're not
really, really bad. And also you have a lot of civil, there are 19 judgments in the court in Ohio against Warren Steel for millions and millions of dollars.
So how are they able to continue holding onto those properties? Even the Bitcoin place in the
barely, I mean, they're all set up in separate corporations. They all have, their owners are, I do believe at some point they may start going after those facilities.
Okay.
As part of the compensation.
You got the layering, right? You got the layering problem. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, Privat Bank is trying to take over everything that's left, which isn't much. And they're in court in Delaware, Chancery Court in Delaware. Okay. And that's playing out. That's a very long, detailed lawsuit that you may want to link to. It may be great to show because it's well written and it gives intricate detail to the whole scam. Okay. Based on documents that were seized by the bank itself, by the government itself, I should say.
So how are Kolomoisky's other oligarch endeavors? I mean, are those still, you know, everything done?
Yeah, no, he's still in operation in other places in the world.
With his other stuff?
He owns real estate. He owns a home in Tel Aviv. He owns a home in Geneva. He has a many facilities in Ukraine. He's fine. He's valued. I think the last valuation of him was much lower. So like 1.1 billion. My guess is it's much lower today. Much, much, much less lower.
Okay. So there has been an effect. So, you know, when you told me the government went after the bank, it kind of surprised me because wasn't the current president, you know, one of his allies. So what happened there? Was there a falling out?
No, he's still friends with Zelensky. They still, although Zelensky tries to distance himself because he ran on a platform of anti-corruption. So it's difficult for him to reconcile. He doesn't even call him a friend anymore. So it's been somewhat strained, but I'd be surprised if Zelensky went after him. If the DOJ indicts, if indictments come down, there is an active grand jury. We broke the story about an active grand jury investigation in Cleveland on all of this. It covers everything. That could lend itself to indictments. And if it does...
Do we have an extradition agreement?
No, we have no extradition treaty with Ukraine. Although Igor is also a citizen of Cyprus and also of Israel. So they've actually even talked about potentially extraditing him as a citizen of one of those countries. Okay. And I'm not going to go out on a limb on this one. So I don't know what our status is with Cyprus in Israel. I should know, but I don't.
Igor likes to layer everything, apparently, even his citizenship.
Or cover all his bases, right?
What point did you come into this story, Michael?
Yeah, it's interesting. We were on a story. I was working for BuzzFeed, and we were on a story also with another nonprofit global called the Organized Crime Corruption Reporting Project, OCCRP. They do some amazing work, and thank God they're out there. when nobody else is on some of these fronts, various fronts. But we broke the first major national story on the back channel campaign. Remember when Rudy Giuliani was running with Lev Parnas and Igor Fruman, another Igor, this one is Igor Fruman, and they were running, they were trying to dig up dirt on then former Vice President Joe Biden. And they were in the throes of this. And I was able to interview Lev Parnas, and I was able to find records and get documents. And then I have my counterpart, two counterparts in Ukraine, Tanya Kozareva and Audrey Belford, were running on the Ukraine stuff. And so we were pieced together a big story on the back channel campaign and how this was going on in Ukraine, which eventually led to the impeachment hearings of eventually this story and others and other revelations that Congress turned up led to the first impeachment of President Trump. So that's how I first got wind of who is Igor Kolomoisky. Why? Because these two operatives that were running with Rudy went to Kolomoisky to say, will you introduce us to Zelensky, who's about to be president? He was the front runner, and they knew he was going to win this election. So they flew to Tel Aviv, where that's where Kolomoisky was then, and says, can you help us set this up? And Kolomoisky basically threw him out of his office. He said, I'm not doing it. I'm not here for Trump. I'm not here for you. I'm not a secretary. You know, and so they left. And then they started this Twitter thing back and forth, and that's what we got. So he became a minor character in the Trump impeachment drama. That's how we first got wind of Kolomoisky. And I started researching him. I go, holy moly, there's more to this than just the back channel campaign and whatever his role was or wasn't in it. This is a big time story. So we started pulling paper, going through court documents, going through, and eventually, you know, we used confidential documents that we got tons of confidential stuff leaked to us. That turned out to be the first story we did was part of the FinCEN Files case, which you mentioned earlier, that was a finalist for the Pulitzer in international reporting. I wrote that last September for the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. Then when I was in Pittsburgh, I went to Pittsburgh to help them launch their investigations team there. I said, my God, there's a Pittsburgh connection to all this, especially in the steel industry and John Goodish. So we did Dirty Dollars, was basically an offshoot of that first story we did. And that's how we journalistically started breaking down the scam in detail. We have more stories coming out. So,
oh, good, good.
We'll send those to you. Yeah, stay tuned. Yeah.
Well, you know, Michael, I just don't know why more people, and that's one of the reasons I wanted to have you on, is because why don't more people know about that? Why do you think more sunlight hasn't been, you know, on this story? Because it's an amazing story. It affected real American lives. It shows how many people were asleep at the switch. It shows how much dirty money is in the real estate market and in other industries. Why hasn't this become bigger? And do you think it will? Do you think it's a matter of just filtering out there?
Yeah, I think personally that I can only guess, but it wasn't in Miami. It wasn't in New York. It was in Cleveland. And I think it's in the heartland of America. Now, a couple things. Those newspapers there in the broadcasting outlet, particularly the news organizations that used to be so prominent, the Cleveland Plain Dealer, Detroit Free Press, other papers there. They're not Chicago Tribune to some extent. You'd think that they would have written about it since the Motorola plant was right there. Detroit Free Press, because they own Michigan Seamless Tube, 40 miles from Detroit. The problem is, I think the resources devoted to this kind of work is not what it used to be. And that's a reflection on journalism. But just think of the area. It's Cleveland. It's not the sexiest. That's a great city. I love Cleveland, but it's not, it is the home of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But having said that, it's not, again, it's not Miami. It's not LA. It's not California, you know, where you still have so much prominent media there. You know, it's Cleveland. And I think it got buried. I think it's one of those stories that's just, that I think more will come out if there are indictments. Right now, there are civil forfeiture actions with stunning levels of criminality alleged by the DOJ. They've already done search warrants into the facilities. They've done all sorts of raids on the offices of Kolomoisky and his partners. So I do think that they're, and they've made several trips, by the way, to Ukraine to meet with their counterparts in law enforcement there. So I think the deck is set for that, but it's Cleveland, you know, and I think it's not LA, it's not New York, it's not Miami, you know, and I think that plays a role.
I guess, unfortunately, in our media, the lives in Cleveland, the lives in Warren, Ohio, man, they're just not as valuable as the lives in New York.
When you think about it, that was the backbone of America. You know, that's the Rust Belt continues, still a great manufacturing area. It's just not what it used to be. And these folks are proud blue collar workers from Pittsburgh to Warren to West Virginia to elsewhere. And they got burned. You know, they got burned. They worked in very dangerous places and were hurt. And it's sad. You're right.
So Michael, before we go, Deutsche Bank. Isn't anybody going to talk about Deutsche Bank and their role in this?
Stay tuned. Yes, a great question. Stay tuned. In the fall, you'll start to see some things, I believe, at some point coming out of Congress, coming out of Washington. Deutsche Bank was a major player in this. And I didn't say this, but I should have. They filed suspicious activity reports, SARs, to basically let the, you know, basically saying, we believe this has all the hallmark signs, or certainly hallmark signs of money laundering.
Well, they did.
And they filed multiple SARs, but just kept moving the money. That was the best. You know, SARs are not a get out of jail card. And because we got privy, the FinCEN files was a leak from Treasury of all these SARs, suspicious activity reports. We found drug traffickers, oligarchs, corrupt national leaders moving money through the United States through U.S. banks. They would just file the SARs, but they're making money on the SARs. And so that's how that continued. That's what won the Pulitzer. That's why we were Pulitzer finalists last week. It was based on that. And it was a fellow reporter, a friend from BuzzFeed, Jason Leopold, who a lot of your Twitter followers will know from his FOIAs. He's the FOIA warrior. Jason is the one that obtained these records from Treasury so that we could all share in them and use them to launch this project. So this kind of came indirectly out of California back to us here. So stay tuned on that too.
All right. Well, Michael,
but that was Deutsche Bank. Yes.
Michael, thank you so much. This has been an honor to have you on here. And I will not only follow the rest of the story, but I'm going to follow the Pulitzer process as it moves forward, because you really did some amazing, you did God's work on this. And I want to have you on again in the future as things move forward.
Well, thanks so much. And it's an honor being here too. Thanks for having me.
All right, Michael. Bye-bye.